As it became increasingly evident that people were trapped, dying and injured in the central pens, Chief Superintendent David Duckenfield told Football Association representatives that Liverpool fans had broken into the stadium and rushed down the tunnel into the packed central pens, causing the fatal crush. His untruthful allegation was broadcast internationally, establishing the immediate portrayal of the unfolding disaster as a further example of soccer-related crowd violence. Indeed, as the previous chapters have shown, the immediate South Yorkshire police reaction was to view through a lens of hooliganism the fans attempting to escape the fatal crush. The media coverage on the evening of the disaster, and in the morning press, was a confused mix of allegation and counter-allegation alongside controversial pictures of fans' faces, distorted and lifeless, pressed against the perimeter fence, while others lay motionless on the pitch. Jack Georges, president of UEFA, condemned Liverpool fans as beasts. Survivors recounted a different story, emphasizing overcrowding, lack of stewarding, and inadequate emergency response. However, more serious allegations against Liverpool fans were made from seemingly reliable sources, first in Sheffield newspapers, and then in the Nationals. Unnamed sources, supported by the South Yorkshire Police Federation Secretary, Police Constable Paul Middup, and a local Conservative MP, Irvine Patnick, claimed that many Liverpool fans had deliberately arrived late at the stadium. They were portrayed as predominantly ticketless, drunk, aggressive and determined to force entry. In the throes of the disaster, it was alleged that they had assaulted police officers, urinated on officers and the dying, stolen from the dead, and verbally sexually abused a lifeless young woman. While these allegations were found to be unsubstantiated by the Taylor Inquiry and the reporting was criticised subsequently by the Press Council, the allegations persisted throughout the inquiries and investigations. Further, and much to the bereaved families and survivors' dismay, the allegations remained prominent and have since been repeated as factually accurate in academic texts, broadcast documentaries, political debate, and popular discourse, including fiction writing, reporting the unfolding disaster. At approximately 3:15 p.m. Graham Kelly, the FA's chief executive, and Graham Mackrell, the Sheffield Wednesday Football Club secretary, spoke to Chief Supt Duckenfield in the police control box. They were told that there were deaths and the match would be abandoned. A gate had been forced and there had been an inrush of Liverpool supporters. Pointing to gate C on a control box monitor, he stated, "That's the gate that's been forced. There's been an inrush." Soon after, Mr. Kelly presented this as the police version of events on radio. At 3:40 p.m. BBC's Alan Green reported live from Hillsborough that there were unconfirmed reports that a door was broken down at the end that was holding Liverpool supporters. At approximately 4:30 p.m. Mr. Green reported on information obtained from Mr. Mackrell, who had spoken to the police officer in charge. Mr. Green stated that at 10:03 there was a surge of fans at the Leppings Lane end of the ground. The surge composed of about 500 Liverpool fans, and the police say that a gate was forced, and that led to a crush in the terracing area. Well under capacity, I'm told, there was still plenty of room inside that area. Later in the bulletin it was stated that the gates had been broken down, following the arrival of large numbers of ticketless fans. By early evening the allegations had consolidated. BBC Radio 4 reported that it was clear that many fans had no tickets, and had entered through an exit gate. One report says the gate was kicked down, another that it was opened by ground staff. Later in the evening, however, the South Yorkshire Police Chief Constable, Peter Wright, stated that the gate had been opened on the instruction of a police officer to relieve the crush outside the stadium caused by the late arrival of thousands of Liverpool fans, many without tickets. The immediate aftermath. The following morning's newspapers presented contrasting accounts. The theme of an aggressive, late-arriving crowd determined to gain entry persisted, with the Sunday Mirror, for example, reporting that between 3 and 4,000 Liverpool fans pushed seemingly uncontrolled into Hillsborough. The Observer attributed the 3 to 4,000 estimate to C.C. Wright, stating that their late arrival had threatened danger to life. It also noted Mr. Mackrell's comment that the disaster had been caused by a surge as Liverpool fans arrived late. While press coverage remained mixed, the assumed culpability of Liverpool fans was central to many reports. The Sheffield Star described a crazed surge of Liverpool fans. It claimed that as a consequence, up to 40 people died in the tunnel, the rest trampled underfoot. Some fans were the worse for drink, others without tickets had raced to the stadium. The Yorkshire Post reported that thousands of latecomers tried to force their way into the ground, having set off a fatal charge. And the Manchester Evening News alleged that fans, foolishly late getting to the game, and furious at the prospect of missing the start, kicked and hammered on the steel exit gates. Thus gates were opened, and the Anfield army charged onto the terrace behind the goal, many without tickets. Late arrival, forced entry, ticketless fans, drunkenness and a charge into the stadium were allegations common to most national and regional newspapers. As the focus on fans' behaviour consolidated, Jack Georges, the UEFA president, stated, "One can talk of people's frenzy to enter the stadium come what may, whatever the risk to the lives of others. One had the impression that they were beasts waiting to charge into the arena." An alternative view was put forward by Simon Barnes, writing in The Times. His comment article, "Why the Dead Are the Victims of Contempt," was strongly critical of the state of football. Why make the football grounds pleasant? Cram them in, take as much money as you dare to charge, that's the way. Spend £1 million on a player, spend the legal minimum on ground safety, and spend next to nothing on comfort. On Tuesday 18 April, writing in the Liverpool Daily Post, John Williams noted that the gate crashers wreaked their fatal havoc, their uncontrolled fanaticism and mass hysteria literally squeezed the life out of men, women and children. It was Yobism at its most base, as Scouse killed Scouse for no better reason than 22 men were kicking a ball. Other reports, primarily from fans' eyewitness accounts, challenged the dominant themes that directed responsibility towards Liverpool fans. These alternative accounts focused on the lack of crowd management in the approach to the stadium, the bottleneck at the turnstiles, the absence of stewarding once gate C was opened, and the failure to direct the incoming crowd once inside the stadium. They also denied that there was an exceptional level of drunkenness, or that fans had rushed the turnstiles or the terrace. PC Midup, secretary of the South Yorkshire branch of the Police Federation, was unequivocal about where responsibility lay. He was reported as stating, "I am sick of hearing how good the crowd were. They were arriving tanked up on drink, and the situation faced by the officers trying to control them was quite simply terrifying." The Sun carried allegations that ticketless fans had arrived and had caused the disaster, either by forcing their way in or by blackmailing the police into opening the gates. Also on 18 April, a more sinister story emerged. The Sheffield Star published allegations that Liverpool fans had attacked police officers and rescue workers and had stolen from the dead. The front page headline was, "Fans in drunken attacks on police. Ticketless thugs staged crush to gain entry." The police, it claimed, were piecing together a sickening story focusing on how Yobs had attacked an ambulance man, threatened firemen, and punched and urinated on policemen as they gave the kiss of life to stricken victims. 18 The report also quoted PC Midup, along with Ermine Patnick, Conservative MP for Sheffield Hallam. BBC Midup reiterated allegations of drunkenness on BBC News. Later in the evening of 18 April, Mr. Patnick echoed the allegations made earlier in the day in the Sheffield Star. "I was speaking to those officers who said they had been trying to save lives, that they'd been attacked by some of the fans, they'd been kicked and punched even when giving mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, and people were urinating on them from the balcony above where they were working." The following morning most newspapers carried the story. Dead fans robbed by drunk fans. They were drunk and violent and their actions were vile. Police accused drunken fans. Police saw sick spectacle of pilfering from the dying. Fury as police claim fans robbed victims. Fans made sex jibes at body. Police tell MP of attacks on them as they helped injured. The Sun's coverage was unequivocal. Drunken Liverpool fans viciously attacked rescue workers as they tried to revive victims of the Hillsborough soccer disaster, it was revealed last night. Police officers, firemen and ambulance crew were punched, kicked and urinated upon by a hooligan element in the crowd. Some thugs rifled the pockets of injured fans as they were stretched out unconscious on the pitch. In one shameful episode, a gang of Liverpool fans noticed that the blouse of a girl trampled to death had risen above her breasts. As a policeman struggled in vain to revive her, the mob jeered, "Throw her up here and we will asterisk her." One furious policeman, who witnessed the disaster on Saturday, stormed to paint all the Liverpool fans lily whites is wrong. "As we struggled in appalling conditions to save lives, fans standing further up the terrace were openly urinating on us and the bodies of the dead." According to a high-ranking police officer, the fans were just acting like animals. "My men faced a double hell, the disaster and the fury of the fans who attacked us. The Sun's response. The Sun's publication was immediately condemned at many levels, particularly on Merseyside. Bereaved families and survivors wrote letters to the newspaper challenging the veracity of the story and its presentation as the definitive version of events. Within days, the managing editor, William Newman, replied to bereaved families. His letter was neither personalized nor signed. Mr. Newman stated that the newspaper had received many letters from Liverpool regarding our follow-up story to the Hillsborough tragedy. He continued, "We are sorry that, possibly clouded by grief, many have not understood that it is the Sun's duty as a newspaper to publish information, however hurtful and unpalatable it may be at the time. On reflection, we accept the way in which the article was displayed could have given cause for offence. For that we apologize. For the substance we do not. We cannot possibly apologize for facts, and to do so would be an abdication of our responsibility to a wider public beyond the city of Liverpool. If the price of a free press is a boycott of our newspaper, then it is a price we will have to pay." Mr. Newman stated that, not for the first time, the Sun had been singled out, and he referred to identical reports in three other newspapers. Claiming the moral high ground, he stated that, "Only by revealing the full truth, we can try to make sure that such a terrible tragedy never happens again, thus ensuring that 95 innocent men, women, and children will not have died in vain." He offered heartfelt sympathy to the bereaved and the injured, noting that the Press Council was investigating newspaper coverage of Hillsborough, and the Sun would accept and publish their findings. Mr. Newman's letter arrived at the homes of the bereaved as funerals were being arranged. It defended the substance of the published allegations as factual, patronized the judgment of the bereaved as clouded by grief, and presented the newspaper as a truth seeker with a public interest responsibility beyond the city of Liverpool. There was no apology other than a dismissive comment that the presentation of the story could have caused offence. Mr. Donlan had inquired into the circumstances of the reporting and presentation of the story, finding against its presentation. His report stated, "The editor is on record as saying that the newspaper had a duty to publish the facts about supporters' misbehaviour, no matter how hurtful and unpalatable at the time. This is accepted, but it must be pointed out that the report, similar material appeared in other papers, did not justify the headline 'The Truth.' Allegations can never be projected as facts. It is for Lord Justice Taylor's inquiry to examine the evidence and decide what happened at Hillsborough. It should not have been published in the form that it appeared." Mr. Donlan's report, while accepting the form of the coverage and challenging the use of the Truth banner headline, did not comment on the factual accuracy of the allegations, nor their origins. Mr. Newman sent a photocopy of its ombudsman's adjudication as published in the newspaper to the Press Council. The Press Council. The Press Council extended the scope of its inquiry to embrace all press coverage, responding particularly to the coverage in the Sun. Editors were informed of the complaint to solicit replies. The Press Council accepted the assurance of many editors that they considered carefully how far it was right to publish photographs that might serve the public interest, but would also distress survivors and the families and friends of those who were killed and were likely to be offensive to other readers. In most cases, however, editors were justified in publishing the photographs. While acknowledging that many fans compressed against the perimeter fence were recognizable and in attitudes of distress, and there was no means of telling how many of those shown died, the publication of these photographs was justifiable on the basis that serious public interest was served by their publication, despite the added distress it would cause. Photographs that focused on a single individual or a very small group crushed against the fence were an intrusion into personal agony and grief too gross to be justifiable. There was no justification for publishing individual pictures of men or women who were known or thought to be dead or dying. In a section of the report entitled On Truth, the Press Council addressed the multiple complaints received about the 19 April edition of The Sun. It found the coverage generally one-sided, offering no counter to the allegations it included. It was unbalanced and its general effect misleading. The front page, The Truth, was insensitive, provocative and unwarranted. The Sun's own ombudsman declared that the article should not have been published in the form in which it appeared. The Press Council condemned its publication. Given the Sun's unwavering defense of the facts on which its Truth edition relied, and the comparable coverage in other newspapers, the panel sought access to documents that would add to public understanding of the origins and presentation of the severe, generalized allegations made against Liverpool fans. The source of the story. Documents disclosed to the panel show that on the morning of 18 April 1989, White's news agency filed a story entitled, Hillsborough. It stated, angry police hit back at Liverpool fans who hampered life-saving attempts after the Hillsborough horror. SYP officers had been stung by savage criticism and by the representation of Liverpool fans as blameless.